We pray that, Lord, we will not colonize this world in the name of Jesus. Your word says, sanctify us by your truth. Yeah, thy word, O God, is truth. Nothing else sanctifies. We won't live here the same, Lord, in the name of Jesus. We will be not just hearers, but doers of this word. In Jesus' name we are prayed. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Many of us are excited to hear the word of God today. Many of us are not excited to hear the word of God today. Okay, so how many of us are excited to hear the word of God today?
Hallelujah.
Okay, so this month we're still talking about understanding the times. And our Bible passage is taken from 1 Chronicles 12, 23 to 38. And I like the way that Sister Obatunde read it to us because, Dr. Obatunde read it to us because we will hear a lot of they were skilled for war. It wasn't really that I heard skilled for war, skilled for war, skilled for war. Did you hear anything like they were skilled for war?
Yes.
Okay. To understand the times, the dictionary meaning of understand is to interpret or view something in a particular way. That's the dictionary meaning of understand. To understand also means to perceive something in a new way or in a particular way. Now, as children of God, our lives, anything that you know or you want to know should not be limited to dictionary meaning. You have to have an understanding of God. You have to know what God is saying about this particular topic. Some of us think something, well, you think this is too small to go to God for. Go to God for the meaning of the word in the Bible that you don't understand. Do we go to God for the meaning of things that we see? You know why we have to? Because the understanding of man is limited. You know why? Because I went into a dictionary and I saw that to understand means to perceive something in a different way or in a particular way. And I checked the meaning of perceive. Perceive means to sense something or to understand something. And in my mind, I'm like, why would you use understand to qualify the word perceive when in the actual fact I'm trying to understand the word understand? It's because man cannot tell you beyond what he knows. And you cannot live your life or you cannot put your life in the hands of one who just uses his common sense for everything. You have to have a God meaning for everything. A God meaning, like even the meaning of what is going on in your life right now. Let nobody come and sit down. Let no false prophet come and sit down and explain to you that this is why the thing that is happening in your life right now, this is why it's happening. Have you gone to God to find out why it's happening? Now we will go to God's meaning of the word understand. The Bible says in the book of Proverbs 4, verse 7, the Bible says, wisdom is the principal thing, therefore get wisdom. And in all your gettings, get what?
Understand.
Is it the dictionary meaning that the Bible is asking us to get? Let's read it again. Proverbs 4, 7. You know, wisdom is the principal thing, therefore get what? And in all your gettings, get?
Understand.
And is it the dictionary meaning of understanding the Bible is asking us to get? So let us turn our Bibles to Proverbs 9. Proverbs 9, 10 to 11. Are we there? Proverbs 9, 10 to 11. What does it say? We'll read it together. Let's read it live. Won't you go? So what is understanding according to the Bible? The knowledge of the Holy One. So it means that understanding the times means having the knowledge of the Holy One in this time of your life. It means knowing what God has to say about a situation. That's what it means to understand the times. You can't understand the times and be in the minority. No matter how small you are, or no matter how small in size or small in number, the number that was used to qualify the sons of Issachar, they only talked about their 200. But if you go from 23 to 38, you will see the number of people who are skilled with spears, skilled to war, skilled to fight, 50,000 who had one heart. All they wanted to see was see that David became king. Even people who were of the tribe of Saul, how many of you know that there were like about 3,000 who came from Saul's tribe and who said, in fact, we have to overthrow Saul because David has to be king. They were determined to fight. But the Bible didn't tell us about the fighting skills of the sons of Issachar. You know why? Because knowledge is an art of war. Everybody there had to listen to the sons of Issachar. No matter how the fight you can fight, Kung Fu or Capoeira or whatever your skills were, if the sons of Issachar said, "We are not fighting today," nobody's fighting. And if 50,000 of one tribe stayed and you had 200 people saying, "Oh, we can't fight today," the 50,000 will sit down. That's how we're supposed to be in our families. That's how we're supposed to be in our churches. That's how we're supposed to be in our nations. Maybe we're not fighting now. And it's okay to say, my pastor understands what we should be doing as a church. My father is a pastor. He understands what we should be doing as a family. What do you understand about what you should be doing in your life? You know, the pastor has a family. So he has to see for his family as well. You have not finished seeing for your life. You want to understand the times for your friends. No, ask yourself, sometimes when people come to you for advice, don't you sometimes sound silly to yourself? Especially when you don't have a clue what is going on in your life. You now want to come and advise another. Knowledge of God in everything that you are going through is important. And how do we find the knowledge of God? The Word of God. The Word of God is the one that reveals to us what God is saying about a particular situation. See, should it not scare you? I think it scares me that this Bible already tells us of gay marriages, gay laws, gay everything, even before we had color television. The Bible has already told you the things that will happen. And you cannot spend time in the Bible to say, "God, what are you saying about this matter?" This Bible is your life from the beginning to the end. I was talking about in the first service how a pastor said that now he's beginning to enjoy the whole Bible. Some of us have not gotten to that place where we're enjoying the Bible. As a child, when I read Genesis, I like Genesis because there are too many stories. Isaac, Jacob, the brothers, Joseph, everything. When I get to Exodus, once I get to that time when they cross the Red Sea and God starts giving them law, I will struggle to finish it. When I get to Leviticus, I will move to New Testament. It's not interesting for me. But the Bible says that all scripture is given by what? By the inspiration of God. Did it say New Testament is given by the inspiration of God? If you look at all the letters that Apostle Paul wrote, he always made reference to the Old Testament because he did not disregard it. He knew that it was the Word of God. The explanation of Jesus, you know, David already started to prophesy of the coming of Jesus. David. How many of us know that? If you go to Psalms, you will see it there. He talked about anointing the Holy One. He talked about some things. When you get to that place where the scripture is no longer a storybook to you, you will know that you are just beginning to live. Listen, healthy people, why do they eat? As you are healthy, you are eating because, one, you are hungry. Once you are hungry and they put a plate of banga soup and they buy in front of you, you'll be, happiness will first come. Then you will not eat and be happy again. Double happiness. If you are healthy, another reason why healthy people eat is because they want to try out a delicacy. Somebody says, "Oh, there's this Chinese restaurant. I tried out one Chinese soup recently, cashew nut stew with chicken. I have never tried anything like that before, and I don't regret it. It's amazing." I would never imagine that they would put cashew nuts in chicken stew and you will enjoy it. Because I've eaten to that point where I want to try something. You know why healthy people eat? They eat because they have appetite. See, I like Sade's meat pie. I like it a lot. And every Sunday morning, I come to the church with a resolve that, except the one they give me as a minister, I won't buy another one. Ask her how much I owe her, because I still keep buying. It's because I have appetite. That's why I want to eat it. Another reason why healthy people eat is because the food tastes nice in their mouth. That's why healthy people eat. Now, let us go to why sick people eat. Are they hungry? They don't have appetite for food. In fact, you force food down their throat. They can't taste it. They can't tell you, this thing is really nice. It tastes like it has cinnamon flavor. Cinnamon. They can't taste any cinnamon flavor in it. They can't taste anything. In fact, you are the one that is going to be feeding them so that they can have something in their stomach. Or so that by the time they use the drug, it won't take a lot. It will not disturb them too much. That's how we are with the Word of God. Why do you read the Bible? Do you have appetite for God? When you go to God, are you hungry? Do you wake up in the morning and like, "Oh, let me hear what my father has to say"? Do you wake up knowing that, "Oh, I have tried Genesis. Let me see what Isaiah has to say"? That's trying new delicacies. But if you eat because the pastor is forcing it down your throat, and you know, I went to church on Sunday, that's what our pastor talked about. There's been a lot of jokes on living deliberately, especially when heaven is my goal. I won't mention their names. But if every time you're only going to say, God save you, if not because of self-control that I left on Sunday, I would have dealt with you mercilessly. Is that self-control? Because they have revealed your intention. So it means that the next, even if Pastor said, and I come back again and I annoy you, you have already told me that it's because of that service you're not beating me. And I already know. So if I annoy you again, you won't refer back to it. You just go straight and deal with me. Some of us, it's the pastor that forces the food down your throat. He forces the word for you so that you will have something to go with in the week. Do you read Revelation the way that you will read Genesis? Would you read Titus the way that you will read Daniel? I saw on Facebook a pastor was saying that now he's beginning to enjoy. Leviticus to him is not like Hebrews. Somebody was asking me, what's your favorite book of the scripture? I said it was Colossians. The Colossians had a lot of good commendations from Paul. And I sat myself that hello, Lagos. Which one is his favorite scripture? I mean, yes, it's good to have a favorite, but if every time you are done, it's only Colossians. Why did the Bible write Daniel for you? Some of us have never opened Zechariah by ourselves. What's the name of that book? Zephaniah by ourselves before. I can't lie to you, I've not opened Zephaniah by myself. So understand that. I'm not saying this because I just want you to begin to ask yourself questions. Am I hungry? When I eat the word of God, is it because I'm hungry? Or is it because I'm just fed? When I open Zephaniah, is it because I want to hear? Or is it because Pastor said that's the scripture for today? And once that's the scripture for today, before some people will open it, you know, because it's always small, you fall to like this. You now turn it again and do like this. You now wait. It has read Daniel. If by chance, unfortunately, it jumps to look, you'll be frustrated. Then you know, you can't let him. That's the thing. We don't let people see us go to the index. I will not watch. I can't understand this pastor says. And what somebody see me doing like this? I won't. So I will be slow. No matter even if they have read 7 verses, I will still keep looking for that man. No, the Bible is. This is your life. It is too important to miss. You cannot miss it. You know why? Because it's the only thing that gives you the knowledge of the Holy One. And it's the only, and what did we say the knowledge of the Holy One is? Understanding. The Bible knows how weak we are. And that's why even Solomon the wise said, trust in the Lord with all your heart. And lean not on your own. Your understanding cannot take you anywhere. See, I'm still amazed that sons of Issachar will stand and talk to people who could use the knife, such that by the time they throw one for you like this, it will hit you in the spot they want it to hit. Sons of Issachar will tell them, it is not time for us to go to war. Permit me to use this war, bear down for you to go to war. Because it was just the right thing to do. Once you have knowledge, and that's why when you write an exam, they have to, you know why they test you? When your teachers teach you something and you fail it, you're not supposed to fail because they have taught you. So what they're doing is testing your knowledge. What is the knowledge of the Holy One that you have for this time? When you have God's knowledge, you will have an understanding of what is going on around you, such that when you are supposed to pray, you will pray. When you are supposed to rest, you will rest. For some of us, when you are supposed to be resting, you are praying, I wouldn't say unnecessary prayer points. Do you know that, we made an instance that, some people will come and say, hey, gay marriages. The next thing we hear, transgender, trans pregnancy. Men are not carrying pregnancy for women. Hey, God save us. So God cannot save you. You know why? He didn't say, what he said is these things have to happen for the end to come. Do you know that that's what the Bible says? So instead of sitting on social media and ranting about what this person has to say, have you ever wondered that, has anybody cared to bother what I have to say about this matter? Everybody wants to hear what Bishop T.D. Jakes had to say about gay marriages, including me. What understanding and what requirement, or what is it that I know that God wants me to be saying at this moment? We are praying the prayer points we should not be praying because we don't have an understanding. See, the times of your life have been mixed up so much so that you don't know what you're supposed to be doing now. And this is not even the time to start to ask if you want to be hot, be hot. If you want to, nothing. All that days of hot and cold, it has passed away. The days that we are now is the day of hot or cold. As it be so cold, you can freeze anything. Or be so hot, you can burn something. See, Bishop Oyedepo gave an instance of light. You are not supposed to be just a shining light. You are supposed to be a burning light. Do you know this thing? If you touch it, it's giving you light. But if you touch it, it won't do anything to you. And that's why flies can fly around it. Have you seen flies near charcoal fire? You can't. And that's why the devil will keep messing around with you. Because why? Because you are a shining light. So you come and give testimony, people say, I like that person, I like the way she lives her life. Meanwhile, you have personal struggles, things that should not even be shackles on your feet. They have become yokes on your neck. Because you're not, listen, you need the knowledge of God for every moment of your life. You are not supposed to be reading the word like a sick person. They are not supposed to shove it down your truth. You are supposed to be reading like you are healthy. Today, I want to see Job. I want to see the reaction. I want to see what God is saying. I'm not saying I'm performing zero and say, oh, today is the day. Job is today. Job is this one. No, if it's not there, it's not there. Ask yourself. Some of us don't ask ourselves questions. Some of us don't. You can be a leader and not know how to fight. Why? Because you are the one giving instructions. How many people, have you ever wondered what you're supposed to be doing now? That somebody should come and tell you and say, Pastor, this is what I feel. I'm just feeling like, what do you think? You don't even know what you think for yourself. You want to not know what you think for another person. The Lord will help us in the name of Jesus. I'll be rounding off soon, but I want to tell you something. Do you know why this Bible is so important? Somebody will read the book of Leviticus and say that it is detestable for man to sleep with man and still want to defend it and say, well, I think it's a sin, just the way lying is a sin. And well, except God give me a personal revelation. If you listen, whatever revelation you want to give, it's not going to contradict what God has given in his word. The Bible says, heaven and earth may pass away, but my word, that's what it says in Mark 24:35. My word will stay the same. Nothing is going anywhere. So if you think you can be playing around, I'm waiting for you. This word is not going to change. See, let me come out and say Ojuri Oluwaseun's international exclusive version and interpret my own and say, blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. I should not say, see, no matter the version you give to the word of God, have you ever wondered that it has not lost its power? Some people will say, I'll get serious. She means they say, at least before the end of will come, all the gospel would have been preached to everybody in the world. I am the class captain of the Preachers International Association. No, I need to ask, because it's when you are class captain, you now know that all the local governments in Somalia, they have heard the word. So now I have to get serious. In fact, God, by the time you stand before God on journey, you say, is that what I called you to let come and do? Do you know the way that, and that's why they pay. If your program is on TV and people are enjoying it, it's they pay you per the number of people who tune in or the number of people you are reaching out to. That's how they pay you. So sit down there and be waiting for the time that somebody will come and announce breaking news. All the scripture has reached the world, though the end has come. No. Live your life in like Jesus is in your back and he's watching you. I gave an instance in Sunday school class that when your mother is, when you are here, when, okay, a stranger is here, you are here, your mother is at your back. A stranger hands you biscuits. And they say, and your mother says, don't collect things from strangers. You did not see your mom, but you smelled her perfume. Or you saw the tail end of her wrapper or her slippers. It might be somebody else wearing this. By the time you do like this, you, thank you very much. And you will return that biscuit. And you will stay there in case the stranger asks you, why? You can take it, your mom is there. You will, as soon as you return that biscuit, 2 seconds, so massacre on bed, you will run away. You know why? Because you can't even be there to let them, your mouth say, to let them feel lawyer 2 times. You know the kind of king that is coming. So if you begin to live your life like God is what watching me. Some of us don't live like that. In First Thessalonians, I gave an instance. My dad said that, he told me this last night, that when I was about 3, 4, or 5, he can't remember, that I just lied. And we went to church and we heard the message. And I came back home wailing. I said, God, forgive me, God. He said I was crying and he was in shock. My mother was surprised. From surprise, she became irritated that, come on, shut up, what's this? It's okay. Even people that kick you somewhere, they will not come out. But I said, leave her, because we don't know this kind of miracle that is happening. Just leave her. And so they left me to keep wailing, like the wailing wailers. And so I was crying, oh God, I'm sorry. I'm at how old? And my father said, but now we don't know how many times they cry again. He was talking to me. And really, after the call, I said, well, really, Oshin, when you lie now, especially when it's something that will favor your work, you were able to handle the situation well. Do you know what the Bible says? By iniquity will abound. Iniquity will multiply. Lying is no more lying. There's not lying. There's not diplomacy. There's not being wise. There's not understanding. There's not being able to manage your customer. That's what is lie, but it's now five action. So when you lie one of them and it's the one that brings business, just say, ah, everybody says, Shimon, you manage the situation so well. I'm proud of you. And I say, ah, boy, I lied. Father, just forgive me. Father, have mercy. And your father forgive me. You are smiling. Father, just have mercy. It's only God that helped me. This is my job. How many times? Listen, where are your tears for God? Where are those things that when you were born again, child of God, once you do it, you go, see, they will be begging to stand up from your knees. Some of us don't even have that passion anymore. We are not there anymore. We don't know what it means. You are just living the life. You are passing with the times. How would you pass with the times? You don't understand the times. You have to understand what is going on in your own life for you to understand what is going on in your nation, for you to understand what is going on in your territory, in your local government. I say a few things before I round off. But ask yourself, now, what does God want me to do in this time that I am? Say, God, what do you want me to do in this time? So that I am not lost. I pray that God will help us. Do you know that when you have the understanding of time, you will be you'll be the mediator. Because clearly, if something should go wrong, all the 50,000 billion people that can fight will go to Sons of Issachar and say, but it's you that say we should not fight. You are the one, you are the face of the group. You will be the one mediating. The Bible says in the book of Hosea 4:6, my people perish for lack of knowledge. For lack of knowledge of the law, lack of knowledge of the word of God. Lack of knowledge of what God is saying in this season. That's why my people perish. Ask yourself, do you have knowledge of the Holy One? What are you doing? What are you doing now that says you know what God wants? Ezekiel 32:36 says, I looked for a man amongst them who will build up the walls, stand before me in the gap on behalf of the land so that I could not destroy it. Bible says, I found none. It means there was nobody who understood what God wanted. There was nobody who understood that God wanted to bring his children back to himself. Who would negotiate? Because for Israel then, they weren't interested in hearing from God. They always to have somebody who would negotiate. There was no negotiator. Some things are happening in our families right now because we're not taking responsibility. Tell yourself, am I taking responsibility? You see certain traits in the life of your siblings. Somehow it's happening funny and you have not noticed. I pray that God will help us. What are you doing about evangelism? What are you doing about evangelism? The Bible says that in the book of Revelation, books were open and another book was open. When you stand before God, what do you think he will say? Let us bow our heads. See, understanding the times is understanding what God is saying per time. But if your spiritual antenna is not sharp, you will not hear Jack. You will not know what God is saying and you will waste your life. You know why? When you are supposed to be praying, you will be reading. When you are supposed to be reading, you will be shouting. When you are supposed to be shouting, you will be keeping quiet. when you're supposed to be talking to God, you will be talking to the enemy. Close your eyes and say, Father, restore my passion for you. Those things that used to make me, those things that normally make you happy, God, let them start making me happy. I don't want to, enough is enough of taking the word of God like a sick person. I want to begin to eat healthy. I want to begin to go into the word because I'm passionate about it. I want to begin to go into the word of God because I want to hear from you personally. The things that make you angry, God, the things that make you leave it, let them be the things that make me angry. Let them be the things that make me leave it. The things that make you happy, let them be the things that bring joy to my heart. Let me be passionate about the things you are passionate about. Lord, let me be encouraged by the things that you show me. I want a relationship with you like never before. Enough is enough of mediocre living. Enough is enough of trusting my life into somebody else's hands. I am responsible for other people and I have not started taking responsibility. Father, please help me. I want you to help me today in the name of Jesus. If you are here and you know that your walk with God has been cold, and you want to rededicate your life to Christ, you want to be able to announce I don't believe that we are treating this topic at this point. I want us to all close our eyes. Sunday school, we are currently treating signs of the end time. And this theme of the month, we are establishing by the grace of God since last year, December. I can boldly tell you that nobody was there. In fact, I can't begin to tell you that there's a reason that this topic is coming. But if you know that you are here and you want to rededicate your life to Christ, please raise your hand. If you know that you already have a walk with God that works, I want you to begin to say, Father, I want a walk with you that works better. I want a walk with you that works better. Listen, you are not raising your hand for anybody. And I have said that this season, thank you very much, this season that we are in is not a season of hot and cold. You are either hot or you are cold. You are so cold, God knows you are cold. Raise your hand very well if you know that, God, I want to start afresh with you. It means saying that you are my Lord and Savior from the beginning again. It doesn't mean counting the number of times I have been a walker. It means I want to understand what my life is. When you understand the time, see, Paul had only one encounter with Jesus Christ. He was not amongst the disciples. If you are not praying, you are doing yourself a disfavor, should I say. Paul was not amongst the disciples, but Jesus appeared only once to Paul on the way to Damascus. And that encounter he ran with for the rest of his life. Some of us have been Christians from the word go. Some of us have had different encounters, but it has not changed us one bit. You're going to say, Father, I am tired. Father, I am tired. I want a fresh start. If you know you're raising your hand, please raise it well. Let me see you. God bless you. Thank you. Thank you for raising your hand. Stand up on your feet. Let us pray together. I don't want you, if you're opening your eyes and you know you ought not to be opening your eyes, I'm sorry for you. If you're standing, just say, Father, I am starting afresh with you. I don't care that they will say that I have given my life too many times. Lord, I have come today. I don't want to go back. Whatever is holding me, whatever is not letting me, give me my best. Oh God, please take it away from me. The things that don't matter to you, let them not matter to me. Dresses, car, houses, Paul did not care about those things. The Bible says, this one thing, he said, this one thing do I do? He says, I'm forgetting what goes, what lies behind me, and I'm pressing forward. I'm pressing forward is what he said. Say, Lord, I want to start afresh with you. I want to start afresh with you. And more, if you know that you're not giving your life to Christ before, please join them. If you know that you have not announced Jesus as your Lord and Savior, please join them. Lord God Almighty, where that we are sitting, we know that we have not gotten anywhere with you. Please help us to live our lives. In the name of Jesus, open my eyes to a new understanding, to a new revelation, to the knowledge of you, Father. In Jesus' name we have prayed. If you're standing, if you're sitting, I want you to begin to speak in other tongues. I'm not saying whisper to yourself. Speak in other tongues. I'm not saying don't let your neighbor hear you. I'm saying don't care whether your neighbor hears you or not. If you know you are standing, I want you to say after me, Lord Jesus, I have come again because I'm clearly sure that this is not my first time. I have come again not because I need help. Please come in afresh, Lord, and be my Savior. Be my Lord and let me never remain the same. Let them see me today and start to wonder why they did not take this decision. decision that I took. I want to begin to have an understanding of the time of my whole life, of my family, of my marriage, of my career, of the life of my children. Lord, please help me. Lord, please help me of my work with you. For Lord God Almighty, I'm tired of what I'm called. I don't want to be a burning, a shining light. I want to be a burning light. Help me to burn, oh God, so that the enemy will not mess around with me. Flies don't stay around in hot food, but you can see them laying eggs on a dead body. I don't want to be dealt with and oppressed by the enemy. Thank you, Father, because I'm starting afresh with you. In Jesus' name we are praying. Everybody still with our eyes closed. If you know you are standing, I want you to please move out. There'll be somebody to direct you and talk to you. I just want you to move us out of the church and fill the forms and submit it and come back. You have not. I want you, as we are now, as sit, I want us to stand up. And just one last prayer and I'm out. You're going to pray and say, Father, let evangelism be a part of me. Open your mouth and begin to pray. It means a lot to you. It should mean a lot to me. I want evangelism, Lord, to be a part of me. In the name of Jesus. Open your mouth and begin to pray.
In Jesus' mighty name, we are praying.